share with you some eye diseases that is commonly diagnosed in Singapore. And then after that will be some eye care tips. And lastly is the digital eye fit that a lot of us is experiencing now, because we are always on digital devices. Okay. So a brief introduction to the eye. So this is our cross-sectional view of our eyeball. Okay. So at the most outer part of the eye is the cornea. So the cornea is the most outer part of the eye. So when we use our hand to actually poke or touch the eye, this is the first layer that we want. Okay, it's a clear, transparent layer that actually allows light to pass through the eye. Okay. Next up is the pupil. The pupil is actually not the student pupil that we see in the classroom. It's actually a small opening over here. Okay, to allow light to enter the eye. Okay. It's surrounded by the iris. So iris is actually a circular disc that actually surrounds the pupil. Okay. So it have a very unique shape and pattern. Okay, just like our fingerprint. So nowadays, you have the opportunity to travel overseas. They have actually upgraded the machine of identification to iris recognition. Okay, so this is the iris. It actually also gives us the color of our eye. So for us Asian, it's usually dark color like brown or black, and the Caucasian are usually light color like blue or green. Okay. Further in, we actually have the lens, natural crystalline lens. Okay, this lens actually is like a camera. It helps to focus light into the eye. Okay. Next, all the way to the back, we have the macula and the retina. Okay, this is where the eye receives the information or receives the light from the outside and then send information through the optic nerve to our brain. Okay, so what are the optic nerve? Optic nerve is like a wire connecting the eye to the brain so that they can send information or send what we see from the outside to the brain so that we can know what we see. Okay, lastly is the vitreous body. It's actually a clear gel-like substance that actually fills the eye to give the eyeball the shape. Okay, so if you ever wonder when we actually stare into white spaces, we see this worm-like or hair-like thing floating around up and down. When we move our eye, it will follow. That one is called floaters. Okay, that is the degeneration of the vitreous body. Okay, so simple diagram. So light will actually pass through the cornea, through the pupil. The crystalline lens will actually focus the light onto the retina, the macula, and then the information will be sent to the brain by the optic nerve so that we will know what we are actually seeing. Okay. So next up, I will touch on blindness. Okay, a lot of people say that, oh, I'm so blind, people are so blinded by love, or I'm so blind without my glasses, I cannot see anything. So what is actually called blindness? Blindness, based on WHO definition, is somebody that cannot see and cannot be corrected by anything. Okay, whether glasses, surgery, all kinds of methods, it cannot correct the vision. Okay, and the vision is usually worse than 6, 3 over 60. So you may wonder, hey, what is 3 over 60? We are not in a maths lesson here, so we are not doing fraction. Okay, it actually means that the person, the particular blind person, has to be as close as 3 meters in order to see something that a normal people can see at 60 meters. Okay, so we have the numerator and the denominator. This is what the normal people, what you as a person, the distance that you need to see something compared to a normal people that can see the same thing at this distance. So imagine a normal people can see in 60 meters, but a blind people can only see in 3 meters. That's how many times more. So can you imagine the person will be seeing something like this, just a shadow of the image. Okay. So let me show you another diagram. So this is something. This is the same target, a target that a normal people can see in 60. workshop or anywhere, they'll say, hey, I have perfect vision, I have 6-6 vision, it is 6-6. What do you mean by 6-6? That means for the same target, a general normal population of people can see in 6 meters, and you, also normal, you can also see at 6 meters. So this is 6-6 vision. So how about 6-12? Usually, I think for Singapore local driving, one eye must be at least 6-12 or better. So what do you mean by 6-12? That means for the same target, the normal people, group of people, normal healthy people, they can see at 60 meter, but you can only see half the distance at 6 meter. So this is how we read off the visual acuity of 6-12. Okay? Okay, let's move on. So, other than the true blindness that we say earlier on that cannot be corrected by anything, and the vision is worse than 3 over 60, there is actually color blindness. Okay, color blindness, usually people will still function normally. They can still see things, objects in front of them, but they cannot differentiate colors. Okay, especially red and green colors. And the most common one is actually red and green color deficiency or color blindness. Okay, it's usually inherited. And actually, it will affect about 8% of the males and about less than 1% of the female. So usually the gentlemen are more prone to color blindness. Okay? So what will happen if you see a normal picture with red and green and some red? Color blindness people, especially red and green color blindness, they will see everything as greenish, yellowish. Okay, this is something to show you what would they see. So in front of them, maybe or during Chinese New Year, everything will not be red, it will be yellowish green. Okay? So next up, we actually have night blindness. So these people will also actually function normally. They can still see things, they can still walk around, travel around. But when the situation is darker or during low illumination environment, they cannot see very clearly. That's like something like this. Okay? So something interesting to share. Previously, I was studying in Singapore Poly. I got the chance to actually do on a project called electron retinogram. Okay? So it's a machine that actually checks the function of the retina and the cells. Okay? So I got the opportunity to also go to SNEC, the electrophysiology lab, to actually test the machine and play with the machine and see how the professor and the nurse conduct tests using the machine. So there's actually a lot of army people coming in to do the test. So we were actually quite curious, hey, why so many army personnel come and do? Then we asked the professor said, oh, because they actually want to gain that they have night vision. So they can escape all the training, they can down pass. But actually with the machine, electroretinogram, it actually tests the cells and the function of the retina, so they cannot gain through this test. So if they say, oh, I have night blindness, then they'll send for the test, and the test come out to be normal, then you don't have night blindness. Yeah, something like that. So yeah, something interesting. So next will be actually snow blindness. So this snow blindness is actually temporary. Okay, so when we are under the sun, sometimes our skin will get sunburned. Okay, so snow blindness is sunburn of our cornea. So the cells on our cornea got sunburned. Okay, in the medical term it's called photokeratitis. Okay, so why? Because the sunlight is being reflected off the surface of the snow. So if we don't wear any protective glasses, or sunglasses, or polaroid glasses, we can actually got this snow blindness problem. Okay, but not to worry, this is not permanent. Okay, so these are the different types of blindness other than the true blindness that we said earlier on. Next, actually, like previously I was saying, people always say, oh, I'm so blind like a bear. She's blinded by love. In the morning I wake up, I cannot find my glasses. I'm very blind, I cannot do anything. Or people with high power, they accidentally, their eyes very dry, they blink, 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 their contact lens drop, then they fly around, or they cannot see anything, I'm so blind. But are they considered as blind?
No.
Why? Because previously I mentioned blind is somebody that the vision loss is permanent and cannot be corrected. So for those who can be corrected, they cannot be considered as blind. So this leads us to this thing called avoidable blindness. Actually, how you may ask it, how can blindness be avoided? Okay, it's not avoid blindness, but blindness that can be corrected. Okay, so one of them is the refractive error, which a lot of us got this condition. Like me, I wear the glasses, but if I wear my glasses, I can see things clearly. I'm not considered as blind. Okay, and the other one is cataract. Okay, because cataract will affect the vision. And if you don't go for operation, you cannot see anything. Your vision can be worse than 3 over 60. But once you go for the operation, your vision will be better, will recover. So it's considered a blindness that can be avoided. That means either you wear glasses or you go for surgery. Yeah. So the cataract and the refractive error, later I'll talk about it more. So next I will touch on the common diseases or common eye diseases that in Singapore, okay, a lot of people are having them. Okay, they are actually first up will be age-related macular degeneration, diabetic retinopathy, cataract, which earlier I mentioned, maybe glaucoma, and lastly will be refractive error. So we will first touch on age-related macular degeneration. It's actually the degeneration of the retina. The center part especially due to aging. Okay, so who are actually at risk? Of course, if you are older, you will have risk lah. So usually it will be age 50 or more. And for those who smoke, you are even more risky in getting this condition. Okay, next up is family history. When we talk about family history here, we are actually, the very strict one will be 3 generations of people. That means from your grandparents to your parents, from your parents to yourself, your brother, sister, and to your to your children, nephew and nieces. Okay, these are the wider family history. But for the simple one, will be just your parents and your siblings and your children. Okay. So if you have hypertension, high cholesterol, diabetes, you are also at risk of this condition. Why? Because blood circulation is affected. So blood supply to the eye also affected, and all this will cause the degeneration to occur. Okay, next up is Caucasian are actually more prone to age-related macular degeneration. In short, we call it AME. And obese people also. And then lastly is people with high fat diet or low nutrients diet. They are actually more prone to AMD. Okay, so let me show you some picture of this condition. Okay, so as you can see for this, this is the back part of the eye. Okay, this is the nerve, optic nerve. Okay, this is the macula. So all these are the blood vessels supplying nutrients or blood to the eye. Okay, this A picture is a normal eye. Okay, so B is actually a cross-sectional scan of the different layer of the retina. So it looks quite okay. Everything quite smooth, layer quite nice. Okay, but if you look at C, okay, you will notice that there is some yellowish spots over here. Okay, these are called drusens. These are all the deposits that is accumulated in the retina. Okay, and if you go and scan the eye, all this lumpy area. Okay, can be seen. So this is age-related macular degeneration. You can monitor and see whether you have this condition or not using this chart called Epsilon chart. Okay, before I show you the chart, I'll show you something more serious. So all the center macular area is affected. So when the person see things, the central area will be generally affected. So you can still see the side, because the side retina are still quite okay, but the center will be all blocked. Okay, so this is AMD. So just now I mentioned about this Amsler chart. Okay, so you can scan this chart to actually see at home and use at home. So usually patient with AMD doctors will actually give them this Amsler chart or Amsler grid to actually self-monitor their vision at home. Okay, how to use is actually very simple. You only focus at the blackboard at the center. Without looking or moving your eyes around, make sure that the four corners are intact. Okay, next up, we look at the lines. Make sure the lines are straight vertically and horizontally. After that, we make sure all the squares are there and not missing patches. So you can see over here, this one artificially drawn out. So let's say you're looking at the middle black dot. Four corners are there because it's quite far away. It's not the central area. But the center area here is actually wavy lines and blurry vision. So usually the patient will not draw so nicely for you, but they will outline the edge, saying that this part is blurry or this part is distorted. Then we will proceed on to do a scan to actually check the layers of the retina to see what's the condition. Okay, so this is AMD. Next up, we have diabetic retinopathy. Based on the name, you already know that this is because of diabetes. Okay, it's a retinal complication due to diabetes, due to poor control of blood sugar. So who are the risky people? What is the risk factor? Okay, people with poor control of the blood sugar. For the ladies who got diabetes during pregnancy. And also people with high cholesterol, hypertension, and people with obese and smoking. Yeah, so all these are the risk factor of getting this diabetic retinopathy. So let me show you some picture of the macula again. Okay, so you can see this is the normal scan of the retina, okay, the macula. Everything is very nice. Okay, why is there a dip? Because this is the macular fovea area. This is where all the central clear vision will be. Okay, but for the diabetic retinopathy, the blood vessel, the blood supply to the eye is being affected. So the amount of oxygen supply to the eye is also being affected. So, but the eye will still need a certain amount of oxygen to survive. So in order to supply more blood vessel or more blood or more oxygen to the eye will actually attempt to grow new blood vessel. So this new blood vessel growing is actually not completed and it's very weak. It will leak or it will break easily. So all these small blood vessels will actually leak and break. Then all the fluid or blood will come out to the layer of the retina, causing the retina to swell. So you can see all these black patches, black spots here, these are all fluids. It can be blood, it can be normal fluid. Okay. So another picture. This is the retina photo. So you can see all the bloods and all the deposits from the blood, all the protein stuff from the blood. So all this. So all this will actually cause the person to have scattered disturbance of the vision. Okay, all these are being blocked by the blood from the juicing or from the deposit. Okay, so yeah, so how? So we are actually talking about a different condition of the different sight-threatening eye diseases commonly in Singapore. So this is the second. Okay, the next one I think. A lot of you have heard before, which is cataract, which is a clouding of the eye natural lens due to changes in the protein structure. And why is the protein structure changed? Because of UV, one of them. Okay. So what are the symptoms? Usually people will experience blurry vision. They see things will not be clear. They will have double vision. They will have cloudy vision because something is blocking the lens. And they will have reduced contrast. And lastly, they will be sensitive to light, and also they will need to change their glasses frequently because the cataract will actually cause an increase in the power. So you might like, I'm not like the young kid, why my power keep increasing? It could be a sign that you have cataract. Okay, so this one you have to also check. So let me show patches is the cataract. Usually it should be clear. But all these white patches, yellow patches, all these are cataract. So imagine all these are blocking your vision when light travels into your eye. It got dispersed because of all these cataract. So when it disperses, everything will become very fuzzy, very blurry. Okay, so when you see the same thing, you'll be blurry. Okay. The contrast will be different because there's a film in front of your eye, it's a cataract. So the contrast will reduce, the light intensity will reduce, you will feel very light sensitive because when the light travels into our eye, you get dispersed everywhere. So you may feel that everything is so bright. Yeah, so this is cataract. Okay, next up is glaucoma. I think a lot of people hear this before. In Chinese, it's called qing huang yin. Okay, it's actually also known as the silent teeth of sight. Why? Because it affects the optic nerve so silently and slowly that you will not experience any symptoms until the very last stage. Okay, why? Because the pressure inside your eye slowly build up. You press against the nerve at the back of your eye, slowly all the nerve under pressure will die off. And this dying off of the nerve is actually permanent. So if you don't detect early, the nerve will slowly die off, and by the time you notice it, you only left with a small portion of your vision. Later I'll show you that. Okay. So it's a progressive, degenerative eye disease that damage optic nerve. If you left untreated, it can be lead to irreversible blindness. It cannot be reversed because the optic nerve dies off. Okay, it's just like when you press something on your hand for too long, that patch will become red. When you press even longer, the area will become blue black, and then ultimately all the cells there will die, and then will something like this. Okay, that's pressing against the nerve. Okay, so who are at risk? People with family history of glaucoma are at risk. Okay, this one very, very important. If you have direct relative, or your parents, siblings have glaucoma, it's best for you to go and check whether you have glaucoma. You may not have, but you are at risk of having. So it's good that you monitor your eye or go and have your eye checked regularly. Next up is those people with systemic condition and those people who use steroid frequently. Okay? When we say steroid frequently, can be those people with eczema problem. So they have very itchy skin that they need to take steroid tablets. Sometimes because topical application is not enough, they have to take steroid tablets. So over time, steroid will actually cause an increase in the eye pressure. And this eye pressure, sometimes you don't feel it. Some people are very sensitive, they feel, oh, my eyes, I feel very pain, very achy. That's one of the signs of increased eye pressure. But some people, they don't feel it. Over time, you will press against the nerve, like what I mentioned, then you will die off and cause this condition for blood. So let me show you a picture. Okay, this is the normal, healthy, normal eye. Okay. As mentioned earlier, this is the optic nerve. Okay, this one is called the nerve running through this area, connect to the brain. Okay, you can see all the brain. All these are the nerve. Okay, it cannot be seen from a photo, but the reflection can see. Okay. So eye doctor will usually focus on this part, the optic nerve. So a normal optic nerve head will be something like this. A glaucoma optic nerve head will be something like this. How to compare? We usually look at the cut at this ratio. This is the disc. The inner one will be cut. So the ratio, if it's getting bigger and bigger, that means the nerve are actually dying and dying off. So it becomes like this, very big. So when the nerve is dying off, the cut-disc ratio increase. This is a sign that you have glaucoma. wide field of vision, nothing blocking. For glaucoma early stage, looks generally quite okay, but actually there's this small area that's being blocked off because the nerve are dying, or not are dying, it's already dead. So they cannot see anything here because the nerve are dead. So if you don't detect yourself, if you don't diagnose and don't get treatment earlier, the thing will progress even further. So you can see bottom tier is being affected. And at the end stage, we're actually left with the central vision only because the nerve at the sides are all affected and you are left with the tunnel vision. So they can still function well, but their vision is being limited. So they walk around, they will keep knocking something. They will just knock the edge of the table or the chair. Okay? So that is also one of the signs they can catch. If you see people, hey, why? Normal people, why they keep knocking and doing? Could be they have that. Okay, next up we have refractive error, which I think most of us have refractive error. Okay, very wordy slides, but let me focus on myopia first. Okay, normal vision, light travel, focused by the lens, hit the retina macular area. For short-sightedness, which is myopia, a lot of people in Singapore might have, they cannot see things far away clearly. They can see things clear near, but they cannot see things far. So if I let's see, mine is not very high myope, but when I take out my glasses, I cannot see things very clearly. Like the sign there, I cannot see very clearly. But when I see things up close, it actually still can, still very clear. So this is myopia. They cannot see things far clearly, near okay. So usually they will squint their eyes, they will blink their eyes. So a lot of people, especially parents with young kids, they will bring their children to the eye doctor and say, what's wrong with my children? Why is the eye keep blinking? It could be of course allergy, it could be of course other problem. But one of the signs could be glaucoma. It could be myopia. Because they cannot see things clearly, so they blink and try to focus. So this is myopia. So next I will talk about this condition called hyperopia. Also, that's not opposition. Myopia, the focus will not be at the retina, but in front of the retina. Okay? So for hyperopia, it's actually behind the retina. Okay, so if you compare, they cannot see things close up clearly. But for far, they can actually see clearly. Okay, so a lot of people, especially young people, you don't see them wearing glasses. They see, oh, I have perfect vision. But actually, most of them have hyperopia. Okay, why? Because they can able to accommodate and bring the focus back to the retina. But for myopia, you cannot defocus and bring the image backwards. So usually people with myopia, they have to wear glasses. But people with hyperopia, they actually don't need to wear glasses. They can still see far clearly. Near object, they can still see depending on the degree of the hyperopia. Okay? So of course, signs and symptoms, they will see things blurry from near. They will have achy eye, they will have cross eye. If the hyperopia is very high, they will tend to cross their eye because the accommodation is too strong. Okay. One more thing to take note. Hyperopia and presbyopia is different. Presbyopia in Chinese is called lao hua. Okay, also near cannot see. Okay, but lao hua only happen for people age 40 and above. So normal young people, if you don't see them wearing glasses, they may be a hyperopia, but they don't need any reading glasses. Whereas lao hua, presbyopia, you need to wear glasses. Okay, next up would be astigmatism. Astigmatism usually occurs when the corneal surface is not smooth, it's not regular. Okay, usually if the eyeball or the cornea is smooth, sphere shape, you will have normal vision. But if it's irregular shape or the eyeball is being a rugby shape, oval shape, you will have astigmatism. You have a lot of focus. lot of people have a combination of either myopia with astigmatism or hyperopia with astigmatism. So this one you have to go and check. Okay, so let me just focus mainly on myopia. So in Singapore, there's a report saying that by 2050, if I'm not wrong, the number of myopia will increase a lot. Okay, let me see the report. Yeah, so by 2050, it's projected, estimated that about 80 to 90% of Singaporean adults above 18 years old will have myopia. And about 15 to 25% of them will have high myopia. High myopia means people with power of more than 500 dB. Okay? So they will have high myopia will actually lead to a lot of other eye disease or eye problems. Okay, so who are actually at risk of myopia? Okay, it's actually everywhere. Okay, why? Especially children. Okay, why? Because if let's say your parents, one of them is myopia, the chances of your children will be myopia is high. Okay. Next is if you have a lot of near work and keep using electronic devices. Okay. On top of that, if you have poor reading habits or posture, you will increase the risk of myopia. Okay. And lastly is the lack of outdoor activity, which a lot of young kids are experiencing this. Okay, they use a lot of electronic devices, do a lot of near work because they started school or kindergarten, or even they started all the training very very young age, and they usually lie around and their posture is no good, and most of the time they are indoor. So all this will actually contribute to getting a myopia. So how can we actually control myopia? There's actually a lot of ways. There's a lot of lenses outside nowadays in the market, special lenses, that actually will help to defocus the peripheral side of the vision. So when the peripheral side is being defocused, it actually tells the eyeball that, hey, you should stop growing already. Don't grow any further. So without growing any further, the myopia will not increase. Because just now, I mentioned before, the myopia is the focal points in front of the retina. So imagine if you already have myopia and your eyeball keep increasing longer and longer, the distance will be further and further apart. So that's contribute to higher and higher myopia. So you have this special lens to actually control the myopia by defocus the peripheral, the sides. Okay, next we actually have contact lens. Okay, it works the same technology, it works the same logic by defocus the sights so that tells the eyeball to stop growing further. Okay? And in the hospital they have eye drops to relax the eye muscle so that the eye muscle is not always in a contract mode, so that the power will not keep increasing. Okay. So I would like to actually touch on this topic called adult myopia. So like I mentioned earlier, a lot of people say, hey, I'm already outgrown already. Why am I still need to change my glasses and my power keep increasing? Okay? One thing, it could be due to visual stress. Like I mentioned earlier, if you keep doing near work too long, your eye muscle is always being in a contract mode. The power, the eye cannot relax and the power will just keep. This will cause the far vision to be blurry, and the near vision you keep accommodating to see. Okay, sometimes this condition will slowly, when you stop your near work for a while, you look far, relax for a while, the eye will actually refocus again. Okay, but sometimes it will not. Then you cause the power increase. Okay. Next is the cataract that I mentioned earlier. Because there's something blocking the eye, so light cannot go through smoothly and got dispersed. So you need to increase the power to actually focus the light properly into the eye. cataract, their power also keep increasing. Okay? So in the optical shop, sometimes we encounter customer or encounter patient who comes in saying that, hey, I just changed my glasses half a year ago, example. Why I cannot see anymore? Then some optician or optometrist will actually look into their eye using a machine, called slit lamp machine, to actually check whether the patient or the customer has cataract. If have, we will advise the customer or patient, or you may want to go and see an eye doctor to have your pupil dilated to check the back part of the eye, which includes the lens. Because if you keep increasing the power, a few months later you'll come and say, hey, it's not clear again. It's a waste of money. Okay. Yeah. Another thing that will actually make the power change is the systemic condition such as the blood sugar level. Okay. So we also encounter patient or customer with diabetes. So we will sometimes they come in the morning, they test, we got this power. They go back, they try the glasses, it is not clear because they collected the glasses in the evening. So the blood sugar change, the power will also change. So this one also very tricky. So after talking about so many eye diseases, we'll talk about how to take care of our eyes. So very simple, standard way, we make sure we eat healthy diet, eat a balanced diet. Okay? A lot of antioxidant will actually help the eye, help the retina. Okay, we maintain a healthy body weight, we make sure we are not obese. If we can, we exercise regularly to keep our body healthy, active. Wear sunglasses, okay? When we go outside, especially recently, the sun is so strong until we cannot open our eyes. It's good to wear sunglasses. Why? Because it helps to cut off UV rays. Okay, all the UV rays will actually harm the eye, especially increase the rate of cataract formation. Okay, so when we choose sunglasses, right, a lot of people want to choose nice, beautiful, unique sunglasses, but the most important thing is make sure the UV filter function is there. Okay, we don't want people to buy just a tinted glasses. Okay, a tinted glasses when you wear, right, it also helps to cut down the rays. Okay, but when you wear the tinted glasses, you see things, everything will be darker. When it's darker, your eye will see that, hey, I need to let more light enter the eye. So your pupil will dilate. If your pupil dilate, a lot of light will go in, which is good, but a lot of UV lights will also go in. So best when you buy sunglasses, check for the UV filter. Okay, when we all wear glasses, actually all these glasses have UV filter also. So for those without wearing glasses one, when you step outside, it's best that you have the sunglasses to actually cut off UV, especially under the sun. Okay, next is actually wear protective eyewear. So when we play sports, or when we special work or job requirement that you need to deal with a lot of fire or sparks, if you can, you go and wear a protective eyewear to actually protect the eye. Next is avoid smoking. And a very important, take frequent eye breaks. Okay, this one I'll talk about it later. And check your eyes regularly, especially you are high risk of all the conditions that I mentioned earlier. Okay. So lastly, about this digital eye strain. So a lot of people are having this digital eye strain recently. Why? Because, but before I explain what, let me just give you a brief idea what is a digital eye strain. Digital eye strain is actually a range of vision or eye-related symptoms such as dryness, tightness of the eye. All these will arise from the excessive use of the digital devices. Okay? The usage of digital devices actually increase exponentially across all age group of people. Okay? The children are having home-based learning now. I'm from ITE. So once a week, students will be staying at home for HBL. Okay? For working adults like us, every time we are on the phone, we are on the computer. So the use of these digital devices has actually increased exponentially across everybody. So now we are spending more and more time in front of the screen. Okay, even after work when we go home, last time is everybody gather down, sit down, eat lunch, eat dinner, then sit in front of the TV, chit chat, watch TV. But now everybody is just go back to their room, lie down and use their phone or watch Korean drama. Okay, so all this will actually lead to this condition called digital eye strain. Okay, of course, all this digitalization and digital thing helps us a lot, especially during the COVID-19 period, but it actually harms our eye also. Okay, so what are the symptoms that we will experience if we have digital eye strain? We actually will have tired eyes. We will have blurry vision, like I mentioned earlier. You read too long or you see something near for too long. The eye muscle is being contracted all the time. It cannot relax. So when you suddenly look up, see far, everything will be blurry. Okay? But of course, after a few relax or rest time, the vision will go back to normal. But some it will not. Okay? Next, you'll have difficulty focusing because if you use too much of your eye muscle, your eye muscle is that strength is that strength. Right? For example, if you go to the gym, you raise a dumbbell, you raise a 10 kg, you can raise it maybe a bit difficulty, and you raise a 20 kg, you may find it very hard to come up. So it's like the height. If you focus too long, too much, or even too close, you will find it very hard to accommodate to see, then you will have difficulty in focusing. Okay, then of course we have dry eyes, because when we are focused on doing something, we will tend to actually forget to blink our eyes. So when we forget to blink our eyes will feel dry. And then we will have headache, we will have brownies. Okay, and we will have a lot of neck pain, back pain also, because we sit too long, poor posture of reading things. So who are affected, who are at risk? Adults, like I mentioned earlier, because now actually not much work from home, but there still is, and even when we are back in the office, we are always in front of the computer. And children who are having HBL. Okay, how to prevent? Reduce non-essential screen time. Not easy, but we try that. So example, after work, we don't see our laptop anymore, we don't see our computer anymore. Try to reduce your handphone time. Play a bit, of course, to relax yourself, but after that, mingle around with your family members. At least you relax your eye, you don't need to focus too much. Okay. Next, we take frequent or regular vision break. Okay. What do we mean by vision break? So, every 20 minutes of near work, computer, handphone, or even we are writing or reading things, we take a 20 seconds of break, okay, by looking 20 feet far away. So like this, you are actually on-off relaxing your eye muscle. So your eye muscle will not be always at a constant contract stage. Okay, so of course, remember to blink fully and frequently. So previously, I heard there's this way of remind yourself to blink fully and frequently. That means when you are typing on a computer, every time you press enter button, or every time when you press the space bar, you blink your eyes one time. But sometimes when you're too focused, you tend to forget to blink. Okay. So next is to make sure you maintain one arm's length. Don't be too close. Too close, the eye muscle will be contract, so it's not so good. One arm's length, eye will be the normal state to see near, and later can see far. So if it's too small, increase the text a bit. Don't go and move your head closer to the screen, or go and squeeze your eyes to see. All these are not so good. Okay, contrast also, make sure that the screen and the words contrast is good. Okay, you don't see something that is not so contrast not so good, then you have to squeeze your eyes or focus too much, it's also not so good for the eyes. So of course, match the brightness of the screen to the surrounding. So if it's too bright, it will cause a lot of glare for the surrounding. If it's too dim, it will cause a lot of straining to the eye. Okay, then you can put an anti-glare screen and then position the light properly so that you don't see any glare and your eyes will be comfortable. Lastly is to, you can place it a little bit lower. Okay, not too low until you have turned the head down. It will cause neck pain as well. But slightly lower, why? Because when your computer screen is slightly lower, your eyeball will actually turn it downwards. So when you turn it downward a bit, your eyelid will actually come down a bit. When it comes down a bit, it actually reduces the surface area of your eyes. So it actually will help to reduce evaporation of the tears, so that your eyes will not be so dry. Okay, then one thing, your eye when looking downwards is actually more comfortable than you look upwards. You may give it a try. It's very easy or comfortable if you roll your eyes downwards with your head up. For a period of time, you actually don't feel anything. Okay, but when you, same thing when you don't move your head, you just roll your eyeball upwards, I think for 3 to 5 seconds, you will start to feel that, hey, there's a bit of tension to the eyelid there. So if you can, you lower the monitor a bit so that your eyes will also feel more comfortable. Okay, next, after hearing so much, there's actually a few eye exercises that can actually relax your eye. Okay, first is this eye movement exercise. So you can actually, after you do a few work, you want to relax yourself, can move your eyes a bit. So you can move up, down for a while. Then move left, right for a while. This one will actually help to relax your eye muscle. Okay. Then there's also this figure of eight. That means you look far away, maybe about 8 feet away or far away. You go and trace an imaginary eight up from your eyes. So you go and exercise your eye muscle. Relax your eye muscle. Okay, blinking, very simple. You make sure you time yourself for this 1 minute, I just keep blinking. Blink hard, blink full, to smooth out the surface of the eye so that your dry eyes will spread the tears properly. Okay, then we also have this pumping. People call it the eye yoga. How? Is to rub your hand together, create a bit of heat already, right? Put your back of your palm against the eyeball and then just rest. Okay, you may find that inside there's this thing running around the eye, then slowly you will die off, then your vision will go back to black patch. That one, relax you. Then you can go down. You want, you can go again, press again. But don't press too hard. Okay? So these are some of the ways that you can actually relax your eye. Yeah, so I think I have come to the end of the talk. So, do you have any question that you are not sure, or just now when I speak too fast, you didn't catch something?
No, thank you for sharing, appreciate
it. Yeah, no problem. So, thanks for coming also. Yeah, the turnout is not very good, but at least hope you all learned something. Especially the eye diseases that we have mentioned earlier.
Are the floaters reversible?
No. Okay, there's actually different kinds of floaters. So one, we have the congenital floaters, because when we are still young, when we are in the the fetus developing stage, there's actually a blood vessel supplying nutrients and blood to the eye, especially the crystalline lens. Okay. So, the crystalline lens. So when we grow up, when the eye slowly get developed, the blood vessel will actually slowly degenerate off, and then the eye will actually absorb all the waste material out of the eye. But some people, when they develop, or when they degenerate, remnants of the cells inside the eye. So young people to see floaters is actually normal. Even for older people to see floaters, considered normal if it's congenital floaters. Everybody ought to have some. But the key thing is, suddenly you wake up, or suddenly now you are sitting here listening to the talk. Next moment you step out of the room, oh my god, suddenly a lot of floaters. Something to worry about. So take note, if there's a sudden increase in floaters or sudden change in the shape of the floaters, it's something to worry about. So you've got to dilate your pupil, which is opening here. The eye doctor will actually check the back part of the eye. It could be due to detachment of the retina. Okay. So floaters can consider normal, but if there's too many, out of sudden, there's too many or change in the size, it's something to worry about. And so whether floaters are reversible or irreversible is actually irreversible. Of course, there's this technology that you can do an operation, go in, suck out the whole vitreous body, which is where the floaters will be, and then you pump in a jelly like things to support the eyeball back, but you don't want to grease your eye for that one floaters that you don't usually see until you really focus and see. Of course, if there's sudden increase in number and size, it prompts you to go and see. So that's what this. Any other thing that you have to do? Oh, yeah. So that's the eye. And the blindness, I think we all are normal, so it should be okay. The eye diseases, so I hope you all learn something from the eye diseases. And of course, how to take care of the eyes. And the last thing is the digital eye stream. So any other question about the eye that you? Otherwise, maybe we can end the session already. So once again, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much.
Well, I hope you really learned something, and hope you understand what I say, although I'm a bit ganjong, and say things a bit fast, so hopefully you'll catch something.
Okay. Very good tips.
Thank you so much. So remember, rest your eye, 20-20-20 rule, every 20 minutes of meal work, rest for 20 seconds, by looking far from 20 feet. Okay, then trace the figure of eight, eye movement, blinking, and the count test, go and do to relax your eye. Most importantly, reduce non-essential screen time if possible. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.